So good morning, I'm Aaron Williams. I'm the Executive Vice President for Government Relations and Corporate Communications at RTI International. And on behalf of all of us at RTI, I'd like to welcome you to this forum to discuss ways to address the impact of shale oil and gas on the economy, the environment, and national security. We're really pleased to have you here with us today, and we're looking forward to a great discussion from this distinguished panel today. As you may know, RTI International is an independent nonprofit institute that provides a wide range of research, development, and technical services to the government and commercial clients worldwide. An important aspect of our work at RTI is conducting research that informs public policy. We host these policy forums in Washington, D.C. as a way to raise awareness of important and emerging issues in science and society. And we convene experts with different perspectives who share their knowledge and research in a way to inform the public policy conversation. We are very pleased to have with us today a group of distinguished experts to discuss the sudden growth of hydraulic fracturing, or fracking, in the United States. This growth has dramatically increased domestic energy production. We've seen a 71% increase in U.S. shale oil production in the past 4 years. This increase has conversely reduced U.S. imports of foreign oil. The rapid shift is such that by 2020, it's likely that the United States will source all of its oil from North America, which ultimately will have a positive impact on our national security, as we can all well imagine. This shift is also driving down oil prices. We've seen a 51% decrease in oil prices in the past 4 years, which has been a significant contributor to boosting the U.S. economy. However, this process for recovering large quantities of natural gas from shale deposits is under great scrutiny for its environmental and public health impact. Due to a lack of research in this area, states are struggling to develop scientifically robust regulations, while the public remains largely uninformed. So today, at this policy forum, our expert panel will discuss balancing the public health risks with economic and national security rewards. Now it's my pleasure to introduce our moderator, Vic Amra, to kick off the discussion. Vic is a globally recognized expert with more than 30 years of experience in energy research and development. He is the executive director of the Research Triangle Energy Consortium. He also serves as a consultant to RTI International. Vic recently published a revised and updated second edition of his book, Shale, Oil, and Gas, The Promise and the Peril. The book offers a comprehensive look at the rapidly changing field of oil and gas production brought on by the growth of fracking. You may have seen a copy of the book as you came in. Vic, we're really pleased to have you here today to lead this discussion. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Aaron. If you don't mind, can you see me? Oh, okay. Oh, you guys can't see, so I have to stand for the back of that side of the room. So I do get 5 to 7 minutes because I am really player coach. So I will be the player on certain aspects and the moderator on everything else. So that, as Aaron said, we've had an amazing change in our fossil energy production in this country, and it's really in two buckets. There's the gas bucket and there's the oil bucket. And they tend not to cross over very much. Oil is pretty much used for transportation, and gas is pretty much used for power and for petrochemicals. So the fact that they don't cross over very much was in part because when you scant 15 years ago, they were in parity with respect to the price per unit of energy. That is no longer the case, at least in the U.S. So in the U.S., the natural gas price has dropped so much. And oil price is a world commodity. See, keep in mind, natural gas is a regional commodity price, whereas oil is a world price. The result has been a lot of arbitrage. And so one of my panelists will speak about arbitrage. Just means, in this case, anything you made from oil, if you can make it from gas, then that's happening. So what it's also done is it's basically made Europe and Asia non-competitive with the US on anything that uses natural gas as a raw material, ammonia, urea, whatever. So for these reasons, and that too will be covered by my panelists, it has decreased the cost of manufacturing most things that use heat or some other aspect of natural gas, and it has displaced coal to such a degree that last time I looked, our CO2 ambient CO2 was down to 1992 levels, 1994 levels, I think. And we didn't even sign Kyoto, and yet we met it. So it's sort of interesting. So that's the gas story, and it brings its own baggage, which we'll talk about in a second. And then there is the oil story. The oil story is more shocking, is more recent. And those, well, actually, Annie is my is the expert in the space, but I'm going to say something, and she might repudiate it, which is that we caused the problem. It was not the Saudis. We added 3 million barrels a day over 3 years, and the world couldn't suddenly just couldn't take it. And what the Saudis did do was not do something. We were the ones who actually did something, which is put a whole lot of oil that didn't used to exist into the, that nobody expected. So that has changed things. In my personal view, it has changed things to where we are the swing producer in the world, which means that we, in a sense, accidentally, are more deterministic on oil price than OPEC at this time. That doesn't mean OPEC is defanged, but just means that it's less able to do stuff. There's the but part. The but is environmental issues. That is an area that if we have Q&A, I'm the one who's going to cover those. And the environmental issues pretty much fall into like four or five areas. I will skim them, and if you have questions, then we can get into them. One is that we use a lot of fresh water, up to 6 to 8 million gallons per well. The wastewater that comes back, its disposal, has issues if you don't do it right. In Pennsylvania, we stubbed our toe badly. Fugitive methane, that is a recent thing. That too, it's only the last 2 years that it was recognized that we would have fugitive methane. That is methane escaping for a variety of reasons in the entire value stream. And then finally, we have earthquakes. And the earthquakes are related to the disposal of wastewater, not directly related to the fracking, although some might dispute that. So that is a very quick snapshot of the environmental baggage that this bounty is bringing. But it is a valuable resource. It is a bounty. It has probably single-handedly lifted us out of the recession. It has made the dollar strong, which some like and some don't like. And so we're going to discuss the various facets of this. So I have panelists, and here's how we will structure it. We'll lead off with Greg Dolan. Now, you got the bios somewhere. If not, we'll get it to you. I don't want to take time. Yes, Cammy is saying, yes, you do. So I won't take time with introducing the CEO of the Methanol Institute. And so Greg is going to give us a perspective on the plus side, which is the manufacturing renaissance. And there's a few in that doubt that we have actually, that word can be used with respect to manufacturing. There's a renaissance in manufacturing driven essentially solely by the shale gas, not the oil. And so he'll speak to what it is and what are the ups and downs of that. We will then, well, I'll tell you who the rest are right now, so let's not get waste time with intros and all that. Then Brian Southwell from RTI is going to get into a discourse which we techies rarely get into, and this is a pity. In engineering school, social science is sort of forgotten. So it is something, and this is the whole the social science aspect of things. What does the public have a right to know? What do they know in this context? And what is effective communication to the public? How the public is affected is the third leg of the sustainability stool anyway. So Brian will speak to that. And then batting cleanup is Ann Corrin. She's a renowned expert in the space of energy security. Now, sorry, national security and energy security and just about anything that she and Gal Luft decide to talk about in the security space. So she's very knowledgeable in just about everything that we'll be talking about. That's why she's batting cleanup. And then after that, I will have a few directed questions, but we'll mostly have questions from the floor. And then the other thing is we are recording this because we actually expected sparse attendance due to Pontiff and so forth. So we're going to record it, and we'll do stuff with recordings. But because we're recording it, video recording it, we need the questions to be on a mic. Now, having said that, I'll be the nice guy in this case. You can go ahead and ask the question from the floor, but I will repeat it. Not because you were not clear, but if you actually go along to the mic, that's cool. But if you don't, I will repeat it, but not for clarity because of the mic, okay? So now we will lead off with, who did I say was going to, Greg Dolan.
Thanks, Vic. Let me start by just talking about the connection between methanol and natural gas. So methanol is a simple alcohol that's largely made from the steam reformation of natural gas. In China, it's a little different. They gasify coal for most of their methanol production. On a global basis, methanol industry is about, our demand's around 65 million metric tons. In petrochemicals, we don't talk barrels, we talk metric tons. But that 65 million metric tons is about 21 billion gallons, to give you some perspective. Roughly equal with the global ethanol industry in terms of our size. Now, when I began working for the Methanol Institute back in 1996, we were actually then the American Methanol Institute. The US was the world's largest producer and consumer of methanol. We had production capacity of 10 million tons, 3.3 billion gallons. And that was when we had pretty steady natural gas prices at around $2 a million BTU. As we got into the 2000s, we saw the price of natural gas climb, $3, $5, $7, $13. And our industry, like a lot of petrochemical industries, went through a rather painful rationalization, where many of the high-cost plants in North America and Western Europe were closed. Here in the US, we went from a dozen plants down to three. We went from 10 million metric tons of production capacity to less than 1 million tons. So we had a very painful rationalization. Around this time, we saw a lot of methanol plants being built in parts of the world that had affordable natural gas. Most of the methanol that we've been receiving here in the US has been coming from Trinidad and Tobago. Trinidad has a lot of offshore gas. They have seven world-scale methanol plants. They also have four LNG trains. Around this time, we also dropped the American from our title. We were the American Methanol Institute. We're now the Methanol Institute. We have offices in here in Washington, in Singapore, Brussels, and Beijing. So we sort of adopted with the industry and became more of a global association. Now, with the advent of the shale gas revolution, we've seen a significant drop in natural gas price, significant increase in availability, and that's led to a real resurgence of domestic methanol production. We've seen plants in Texas that have been mothballed for a decade being brought back to life. One of our member companies, Methanex, has moved two plants from Chile to Louisiana, literally cut up large industrial complexes and moved them by ship over to Louisiana to take advantage of the low-cost gas there. So we've seen now over just the last couple of years, U.S. methanol production climb from under 1 million tons to 4.3 million tons, which is about 1.5 billion gallons. Within the next few weeks, we're going to see another plant open, a joint venture between Celanese and Mitsui in Texas, capacity of 1.3 million tons. Before the end of the year, the second of the two Methanex plants will begin operation in Louisiana. That'll add another 1 million tons. We've seen announced plans for new methanol starts, about a dozen projects. And if you add up all the plans to build methanol plants, we could see our production capacity go up from, again, today, 4 million tons to 20 million tons. And that would be equal to 6.5 billion gallons. So we're not going to see all those plants built. It's easy to put out a press release and say we're going to build a methanol plant here or there. It's a lot harder to get the capital and for the investment and to actually build the plant. When we're looking at these facilities, each one costs about $1 to $2 billion. Each plant will create 2,000 to 3,000 construction jobs, and each plant will create 200 permanent high-paying jobs. And those are the kinds of stories that Washington really likes: investment, jobs, tax revenue. So I think methanol is part of this really good story that's coming from the shale gas revolution. Now, some of the plants that we're seeing built in the US are being financed by foreign entities. Just last Friday, Yuhan Chemical held a ribbon cutting in St. James Parish, Louisiana for a methanol plant, $1.85 billion investment. The company is owned by Shandong Yuhan Chemical, which is a Chinese entity. And this represents the largest direct foreign investment from China in the state of Louisiana. We've also seen announced plans for another group from China to build three methanol plants in the Pacific Northwest in Oregon and Washington states. So we're seeing a lot of this investment coming into the United States. And our industry is not alone. The American Chemistry Council right now is tracking some 246 new chemical plants based on natural gas that have been announced for the U.S. That's an investment of about $150 billion. 29% of those plants are under construction now. By the year 2017, these facilities are expected to add 284,000 jobs in the U.S. So again, that's a really positive story for our industry. In terms of the connection to natural gas, the Energy Information Administration has noted that industrial facilities, including methanol and ammonia plants — ammonia is a fertilizer, is also a big consumer of natural gas — but industrial facilities consume an average of 21 billion cubic feet of natural gas per day last year. And that's an increase of 24% over 2009. So we're seeing a real renaissance in these petrochemical industries based on natural gas. Now, that added supply of methanol in the U.S. has also led to a steep decline in pricing. At the beginning of the year, methanol pricing was considered high at $1.25 a gallon. We now have an average spot price of about 84 cents a gallon, and we've seen cargo sales as low as 75 cents a gallon. Now, before he became the energy secretary, Ernie Moniz was at MIT, where he chaired a study on the future of natural gas. And they found that the production of methanol from natural gas was the most efficient and economical way of getting our natural gas resource into our fuel tanks in our cars. That report urged the U.S. government to have a requirement for tri-flex fuel vehicles. That's cars that are capable of running on gasoline, ethanol, or methanol. That kind of alcohol capability costs just $100 a vehicle. So it's a very affordable way of giving the consumer choice at the pump. Looking at today's pricing, recognizing that oil and gas prices are also more artificially lowered, if we were going to be selling methanol at the pump today, it would be M85, which is 85% methanol, 15% gasoline. We have a lot of E85 sales in the U.S. But if we were to sell that today, and recognizing that methanol is about half the energy content of gasoline, we'd still be looking at an effective pump price for M85 of $2.39 a gallon today. The EIA last week had the average U.S. retail pump price at $2.50 a gallon. If we were to add a little bit more gasoline to that mixture and sold M70, 70% blend, then we'd be looking at an effective pump price for the consumer of $2.23 a gallon. So we see some real value there. Now, in the U.S., we have some 17 million ethanol flex fuel vehicles that are capable of running on up to 85% ethanol. There are some 3,300 fueling stations that sell E85, which represents just 2% of the total retail fuel networks. While there's not a lot of really good data about the actual consumption of E85 in the U.S., the Energy Information Administration had one estimate that it's about 40 million gallons. And that amount of ethanol sold for E85 has been relatively flat over the last 5 years. To put that in comparison, we consumed 14 billion gallons of ethanol for E10 blending in gasoline. So if you look at that 40 million gallons over 17 million ethanol FFEs, that comes out to about very low amounts. So we're talking about like 2 or 3 gallons per vehicle a year. And if you look at the number of retail fueling stations, those fueling stations sell about 33 gallons of E85 a day. An average retail service station sells 4,000 gallons of gasoline. So we're just not seeing a real uptake in E85. And also, under the Corporate Average Fuel Economy Program, currently those flex fuel vehicles receive a credit towards the increasing miles per gallon of the car fleet. That credit program is expiring with the end of the 2016 model year, so the automakers will have no more incentive to keep building ethanol flex fuel vehicles. We think that should change as well. We believe that methanol has an opportunity to provide the consumer with real choice at the pump. We've been supporting legislation introduced in Congress, the Fuel Choice and Deregulation Act. That's Senate Bill 889 and H.R. 1944. It was introduced in the Senate by Rand Paul, who happens to be running for president, and in the House by Rod Blum. This bill would provide automakers with a real incentive to introduce these fuel choice enabling vehicles, an incentive of 8 miles per gallon towards their corporate average fuel economy. The automakers have to get to 54 miles per gallon by 2025, so they need this kind of incentive. So that's legislation that we've been supporting. We think there's a real opportunity for methanol in the U.S. fuel pool. Thanks, Vic.
Thank you, Greg. So let me just make one parenthetical comment, add to what he said. One of the reasons we emphasize methanol in this panel is because methanol, as he pointed out, Ernie Moniz thinks so too, but it is true, which is that it is the easiest, cheapest conversion of natural gas or methane into something valuable. The next step would be something like dimethyl ether. So that's why methanol is really an example of the various chemicals that could be produced from cheap natural gas. He mentioned it, and I will underline it. Ammonia is one. Ammonia fertilizer is one. Is another one. And these are all things we were net importers of. And very shortly, we will probably be at least self-sufficient at some point in time. So now we will go to Brian Southwell, who will go ahead and say whatever he wants to say on the whole societal implications.
Great. Well, it's really great opportunity to be here and be part of this discussion. And I'm happy to offer a perspective on social science research in this arena. Before I do, though, I want to offer a caveat, which is that social science research in this arena very much is nascent. And it's really only been for a couple of years that we've seen good peer-reviewed work coming out on this phenomenon. We also, in a lot of ways, know that from decades of work on public opinion research, that public opinion for novel issues, like shale gas and oil, in a lot of ways, it can be very fluid. Pardon the pun in this instance. But we know that public opinion and public perception, it can be volatile and can change quite a bit depending on the information environment. So what we know in terms of public opinion in 2015 is not a perfect forecast of where we'll be in 10 years. A lot of that's going to be dependent upon the evolving information landscape and other factors we can talk about. That said, there are some things that I wanted to talk about with regards to recent literature. First, in looking at what's been done, there are some important limitations. Some of those have to do with the samples that have been used for public opinion, public perception research in the U.S. A lot of that work, understandably, has focused on geographically specific areas. So you have a study of residents living on or near the Marcellus Shale, for example. There has been at least one national study, and we can talk about that, but there has been a lot of really focused work. And so that might be an opportunity for future work that would look a bit more broadly. Second, in doing survey research, there are trade-offs. And often there are limitations in terms of time available and other constraints. And survey researchers will tend to rely on closed-ended questions. One of the things that we know for new and novel areas of research is that people are able to respond to closed-ended questions. However, that may not capture all of what would be in their mind if you were to ask them in a more open-ended format. There's a paper that came out by Israel and colleagues this year, for example, that used an open-ended brainstorming session, and folks were able to generate quite a long list of both potential concerns and benefits. It was really much longer than would have been captured by some of the conventional closed-ended questions. So two important limitations. There are some ideas, though, that I think we should be comfortable putting on the table in terms of research up to this point. One is that there is well-documented and prevalent uncertainty amongst participants in surveys. You can look at levels of support, but there has been a really good work to ascertain that there are large numbers of people that will openly admit to being relatively unfamiliar with the processes of discovery or production. Hilary Baudet and colleagues, for example, did that national study that I mentioned just a minute ago and found that a majority of the participants in her survey work admitted to being unfamiliar really with the basics of hydraulic fracturing. That is important to keep in mind, again, in terms of forecasting where public sentiment might go. Similarly, Theodori and colleagues found that almost half of the folks in their sample admitted to some degree of uncertainty. We also know that framing matters quite a bit. There's a paper that just came out this year by Christopher Clark and some other researchers that found, maybe unsurprisingly, referring to this phenomenon as fracking is more likely to solicit negative perception than the simple description of hydraulic fracturing. That has implication for both educational materials, but it also has implication for the public opinion and public reception research that gets done. And so it's worthwhile to pay attention to the wording in measurement. We know that there does seem to be widespread support for some degree of regulation. At least at the level of disclosure as to what chemicals, for example, are used. And we see this, and there have been a number of studies where they found that the majority of respondents will acknowledge that with this new phenomena that some degree of oversight is going to be important. And with regards to risk and benefit trade-off, I think when given a more nuanced discussion, people are able to grasp and grapple with the various trade-offs, and we find that people are generally able to rank risk, at least at the level of being able to put in a hierarchy shale gas and oil lying somewhere between conventional fossil fuels and renewables. And that's something that, again, has been documented. There are different dimensions here that we might look at. I think it's important probably to go beyond just simple support in a yes-no support or not support type of framework to also think about layers of support. To what extent are people, for example, willing to pay to mitigate or for various remedies? Those are dimensions worth further exploration. I think that the best way to have this discussion today is to view this as an agenda for future research. This is an area that very much warrants a social scientist doing this work in collaboration with folks like my fellow panelists. And I think that there's work to be done both in terms of regional and national comparison within the US, but also for international comparison that's not yet been done. We don't know very much about the predictors of support. We know there has been work to try to look at bivariate associations and correlations between demographic factors and support. For example, there's some evidence that women or folks living in urban areas might be leaning against this general notion. There's some evidence that folks with more education might have greater support. But we have to keep in mind that we don't necessarily know all of what those demographic factors are confounded with. And so I think that there's more work to be done to unpack all of that. We also need to find out more about the vulnerability of and the responsiveness of public sentiment to the information environment. And to do that, we're going to have to do a better job of tracking news coverage, of actually looking at patterns of information over time, and looking at the degree to which that seems to be related to public sentiment. Because as I said in the opening to my remarks, we know that public sentiment is fluid. And we know that it is, on some level, responsive to new pieces of information. Those pieces of information might be things like Vic's book, but there are other news coverage and other elements out there that that may shape perception ultimately. And the last that I'll just note is that there's an interesting sociological opportunity here, I think, to look at the creation of, the coalescence of, and the the patterns over time in social movements, whether they be either for or against in this case. I have a colleague at Vanderbilt University who's done some interesting work in other sectors of the energy arena, David Hess, who's looked at ways in which members of movements find each other, communicate, and organize. And I think that that's useful information for a variety of different perspectives in this arena. So I'm happy to contribute, but thank you for the chance to be here.
Thank you, Brian.
Right on time, by the way. So now we'll have Anne Corrin. So what I asked, she's batting cleanup, she can speak to anything. She can actually speak to all of these issues, but what I've asked her to particularly speak to
is the, whether she adhered to it or not, we don't know yet, is to national energy and national security issues. So national energy security as well as national security as a whole. And if you would want to allow yourself to do it, to, I'm suggesting that what has happened now with the price of oil dropping, that we are affecting the world order in some way, and which is a little broad statement. But if you'd venture into that space, that'll be wonderful too.
Well, why don't we start with that?
Okay.
Look, there are some tremendous issues going on in the world, in the Middle East in particular, that have allowed the shale production in the United States to have an impact on the oil market. And what I mean by that is OPEC definitely has the ability to drive the price of oil up. All we have to do is engage in a thought experiment. If the Saudis decided to do something very drastic that's almost impossible for people to envision today, but if they decided to cut production by 5 million barrels a day, we know that oil prices would shoot up tremendously, and they would actually be making more money per day than they are now. Not just more money per barrel, but more money per day overall. So the fact that they're not choosing to do that says they have a good reason not to do that. And we can try and analyze what the reasons are. Certainly one reason was trying to undermine the industry in the US, trying to see, to find where the tipping point is for the industry. And I don't think they've found that yet. It remains to be seen what happens with the industry's debt service and so forth. But it's not clear where the tipping point is for the industry, what the tipping price point is. But the other issue, and it's very, very important, a real critical issue, is, and the Iranians have put this out there most clearly, the Iranians believe that the Saudis are engaged in economic warfare against them. Because within OPEC, we have members that, to put it mildly, don't like each other. And while they all have an interest in maintaining the price of oil relatively high because they need to hit their fiscal break-even price, that means the price of oil required to balance their national budgets. It has nothing to do with the break-even price for a company. The input into their budget is sales of energy. The output is, you know, social services, weapons purchases, et cetera, et cetera. The pricing hawks within OPEC, like Iran and Venezuela, require much higher price of oil to balance their budgets. The pricing doves like Saudi require a bit lower price of oil, have, like the Saudis do, tremendous reserves of currency, of cash, with which they can, they can tap into to meet the shortfall. But the Saudis, Arab Sunnis, are very, very concerned about Shia, Persian, Iran going nuclear. And I think we need to start to listen to what various regimes in the Middle East are telling us on different issues. Gaddafi, before he was deposed, to take an example from a completely different area, Gaddafi, before he was deposed, said, I am the blockade between Europe and mass migration. He was right. Okay, we ignored him, but he was right. And we're seeing the results today, potential of tens of millions of people flowing from Africa and the Middle East into Europe. Gaddafi really served as a sort of bulwark, as a sort of blockade protecting Europe in a way. From a big problem Europe's going to deal with. The Saudis say very clearly, we will not tolerate a nuclear Iran. If Iran goes nuclear, we're going nuclear. And remember that the Saudis financed the Pakistani nuclear program. They had access to it that the Pakistani prime minister did not have. So that's one thing. So the Saudis have a very good reason to keep the price lower than would be comfortable for Iran. How long in the future will that reason remain, and will that reason balance out their need to, you know, keep the masses from storming the palaces? They have a long breathing room, but it's not endless. And let's not forget that the price of oil where it is today will, of course, drive increases in demand, which will make their job easier. Because the higher demand, the less they need to reduce supply in order to make prices go up. Other factors that we need to think about. I really believe that with this infusion of what's going to be over $100 billion infusion into Iran, and with the clear statements of Iranian leaders against what they perceive as their enemies around the world, there is no way that we're currently on our current path with removing sanctions and all. We've basically abandoned all the tools to thwart Iran from getting a nuclear weapon. Peaceful nuclear power in the context of the Middle East, as Gal and I wrote many years ago, is an oxymoron. We can sing kumbaya all we want, but we've effectively dropped the ball on this. And so that means that we are headed towards a Sunni-Shia nuclear arms race in the Middle East. You can imagine what that means in the context of the oil market. Nothing good. Nothing good. And so to my mind, the most important part of the shale revolution in the US is the gas part. The oil part is fantastic because it has tremendous trickle-down economic benefits and so forth, but it's not going to be a game changer in the oil market over the long haul. But the gas part could be a game changer in the oil market. If we do what both you and Greg have alluded to and open up the transportation fuel market to competition. Because what we really need is arbitrage between oil and gas and oil and coal and oil and, you know, corn and oil and sugarcane and oil and even the various sources of electricity that because electricity can be used to fuel transportation as well. But if we open the transportation fuel market to competition, then we have commodity arbitrage that will force the price of oil down to where these other, with of course expanded capacity in non-petroleum transportation fuels, will force the price of oil down to where these other fuels are economic. And that means a $40 to $50 price band. You know, more or less where we are now, which is certainly much better than $100 or $150 price band. And so public policy, the bill that Greg alluded to, collaboration with the Chinese, because the Chinese and the US together account for 40% of vehicle manufacturing globally, to open their vehicle market to transportation. And they certainly have made tremendous progress in doing that because of their coal sector, is absolutely critical for not just energy security of the United States, but really the security of the free world as I see it. Because as long as oil is a strategic commodity, then countries that are inherently unstable, that are inherently opposed to all the ideals that we hold dear in what we think of as the free world, over the long haul will certainly have the upper hand. Because they're the ones that have the bulk of the cheap to produce oil.
Okay, so that's a big mouthful. So let me start with asking first, Greg. So the way this will go is I'll ask the first questions and then see if there's anything on the floor, and if you guys don't come forth properly, then I will keep on going until you do. The first question is to Greg is, I think it's arguable that China is the leader in the use of methanol in displacing gasoline, you know, whether it's from M15 to M75. And I would like you to pile in on that answer as well as to what were the motivations, to what degree were those motivations vitiated by the fact that the price of oil is dropping? To further, what degree is it vitiated by the fact that they are now building a strategic petroleum reserve? Any and all of the above, if you give a quick kickoff for like a couple of minutes, and then Annie, I would like you to add to that.
Sure, thank you. Yep, China is, like a lot of things, the world's largest producer and consumer of methanol, also the largest user of methanol as a direct transportation fuel. Last year, the Chinese consumed 35 million metric tons of methanol, 10 million tons, or 3.3 billion gallons, was put in their fuel tanks. Most of it blended with gasoline is M15. It's 15% methanol, 85% gasoline. And that fuel, that 3.3 billion gallons is M15, is being used in the existing fleet of passenger cars. It's sold at the pump as 95 and 97 octane fuel. The domestic automakers in China produce less than 25% of the cars that are sold in that market. So 75% of the cars today in China that are running on M15 were built by GM, Audi, Volvo, the international OEMs. those cars are not any different from the vehicle platforms that they sell globally. So it's a great experiment showing that the world's auto fleet is much more capable of running on alcohol fuels, including methanol, than the automakers are really willing to admit. The reason they're doing this in China is primarily for economics. The cost of methanol is roughly one-third that of gasoline, even in today's low oil price environment. The Chinese government controls the retail pump price, and companies have to buy oil and gasoline on a world market, so it makes sense for them to put something cheaper into their fuel mix. About 40% of the methanol that's used as M15 is done illegally, simply because of the economics. They're just putting it into the gasoline. Most of that methanol is used in 14 provinces that have their own specification for methanol fuels. So we're seeing a real uptake of methanol as a direct transportation fuel in China. It grows at about 20% a year. The Chinese, in just the last couple of years, have converted 160,000 taxis to run on methanol, on M85, 85% methanol, and even M100. To put that in comparison, in the US, we've been pushing natural gas vehicles for decades, and our fleet is maybe 140. Those taxi drivers in China are putting a third more money in their pocket every month by running on methanol fuels. We've now had one of China's largest automakers, Geely, which also owns Volvo, is building a plant right now in Shanxi province that will produce 250,000 methanol cars a year. These are dedicated cars that are going to be running on methanol fuel. So that's a big part of our story, is the success in China in using methanol as a fuel. They always ask me, well, why aren't we doing it in the U.S. if it makes so much economic sense?
So, Annie, if you could add to that, particularly on the point of how is the lower price of oil affecting, if at all it is, and are there motivations such that the lower price of oil really doesn't matter, and also their petroleum reserve, if you know anything about that, yeah.
Well, even with the lower price of oil, methanol, remember the price of fuel in China is controlled, but it's controlled to reflect, they update it very frequently to reflect more or less what's going on in the market. So it's a more or less realistic price, even though it's not a constant market price. But it's still more economic for them to use fuel made from coal. And one of the reasons, and Greg maybe can go into that, is that they have a lot of inland coal that's not getting to the international market. So it's not a global market price of coal.
So local jobs?
The coal is cheaper, because how are you going to get it out? You need rail lines, enough rail lines to get the coal out. So here's a fantastic way to utilize that coal. You liquefy it, you use it for transportation, you get a cheaper cost. Not only you get a much cheaper transportation fuel locally, you get cleaner air locally. People are always shocked to hear fuel, transportation fuel from coal, alcohol from coal. Think of it, take alcohol and burn it. It's really clean. There's no soot, it's not dirty. So transportation fuel from coal, when you're looking at alcohol, has tremendous air quality benefits. If we're looking at the pollutants that damage human health, it's a huge boon. And China doesn't care about greenhouse gas emissions. China cares about breathing. Okay, so when it comes to breathing, transportation fuel from coal is probably the best thing that China.
So speaking about breathing, diesel is worse than gasoline. Is there anything going on in diesel and methanol?
Well, this is really fascinating. Actually, we co-hosted a heavy-duty vehicle workshop in Beijing, a methanol heavy-duty vehicle workshop, to see what the Chinese are doing on heavy-duty vehicles. And there really is tremendous work being done in China to open up the heavy-duty sector, trucks, to methanol. And there are different ways of doing this. There's certainly tremendous work being done at MIT also by Dan Cohn, who was working with Ernie Moniz when he was at MIT, when he was a regular guy. So using methanol in heavy-duty vehicles, using DME in heavy-duty vehicles, there are a lot of paths to move forward on this, but to utilize whether coal or natural gas, whatever makes economic sense in a given area, are also tremendous boons, not just for the local economies and for energy security, but what really concerns China, for air quality. Natural gas, look, in China is a very different story than in the US, obviously, because natural gas is a regional commodity. And in fact, the coal industry in China managed to move a regulation that basically forbids making methanol from natural gas. It's not relevant right now because natural gas it would be more expensive to use than methanol, but it shows you, you know, that there are a lot of people that have an interest in keeping the coal industry alive and kicking there.
Okay, thank you. So, Brian, let me ask you. You said something which a little bit surprised me. The public is able to rank risk, okay? And then you also said the public doesn't know what they're talking about because they're misinformed. Well, we don't inform them enough. So there is something awry there. I said that perhaps folks feel they can rank risk. So can you connect the dots for me there as well as add perhaps what types of information and what modes of communication might be most effective to where now the ranking might be more realistic?
There's a lot in what you asked.
Sorry, okay, pick any one of those.
Case, right. I think we probably could make some distinctions there. I'm not sure that it's a matter of being misinformed, but rather not necessarily being completely certain about what they do know. There have been studies in asking people to assess the relative risk of various sources, and under those circumstances, many people, a bulk of respondents, place that group of shale gas and oil in that hierarchy in a way that I think many of us would agree is roughly correct. And so I think that there's that capability. I think the admission of uncertainty is one that has to do with the details of production, but also with the range of risks per se. And that's something it's going to be interesting to see over time. I do think that people are variously sensitive to different types of risks. We see, for example, in some of the literature on willingness to pay to remedy or to mitigate, there seems to be greater interest in or greater support for, greater willingness to pay for remedies for surface water harm, for example, as opposed to policy to offset or mitigate the extra truck traffic that might come in an area, which again is a risk, something you might think about. But really, at the end of the day, people are oriented towards personal harm, and I think that we tend to think about the potential public health circumstance here, and I think one way to think about this is in terms of personal health, and that tends to be a motivating factor. So I in terms of avenues for for discussion here, I think that at the moment, one way to characterize the predominant mindset is of a mental model without many pieces or nodes. I think that people have a general sense of associations with the notion of fracking or with hydraulic fracturing or with shale gas. Whether they're even always connecting those is interesting. I don't think most people are at a point of being able to connect all of the dots that you all are in terms of thinking about international relations and thinking about the offsets and the trade-offs and the relationships to markets. I think that that's an area where there's quite a bit of room for greater education. I think that there is some hunger and appetite for information about this new phenomenon. I think that a lot of it tends to be either in business journalism or in international relations, or there's some scientific discussion. We don't necessarily have a lot of broadly open and accessible discussions of this. There's been some popular media depictions of various processes. Whether or not we always see sort of a full and objective view and an effort to kind of break down some of the jargon, I think that's that would go a long way. So I don't know, Vic, if we can solve all those problems today, but that's at least a start. I don't know if that helps to clarify.
Okay, no, I didn't mean to say. Yeah, in fact, I think, in my view, that is an area that really needs attention because the public is being impacted. It is the third leg of the sustainability stool. So to ignore the public is ridiculous. And yet, if the public is not informed, whatever that means, I mean, I was very curious your observation that the word fracking as a pejorative was slanting opinion. Is there research on that in other pejorative terms that are deliberately used? Does that happen a lot? Is that several percentage points?
Well, there's a wide literature on the the impact of framing on public perception, which is both important, as I mentioned, as a broader phenomenon, so just the very way that we think of and conceptualize, but also just something that it does have an impact in terms of the specific words that are used in survey questions. And that often, unfortunately, is sometimes glossed over in journalistic headlines about this. And so I think that's important to keep in mind, that people are often able to, what they have to respond to are the words in the question. And we haven't necessarily always gone further to recognize how much people are connecting all the vocabulary words that that we're talking about here. Because it's a new phenomenon. And I think that it was part of the reason for being, Vic, for your book and for the work of the other panelists, is just to explain some of these ideas to a broader public. So I think it would be well served to recognize. I did not mean to suggest that in suggesting that public opinion is based on relatively shallow resources sometimes, it's not to suggest people don't have the capacity. It just means that they don't necessarily have a lot of information on which to base opinions. To suggest that we are at a point of uncertainty doesn't mean that people couldn't get to a greater point of certainty. So I want to make sure we make that clarification.
Okay.
Can I jump in?
Absolutely, you may.
I so well agree with what you're saying, and I remember something, that's why I'm smiling. I remember this whole internet hoax campaign about dihydrogen oxide, banning dihydrogen oxide, this dangerous chemical, because people couldn't recognize that dihydrogen oxide is just H2O, right? And so terminology is so important, because our public, large parts of the public, are so tremendously, even the people that love science, are so tremendously ignorant when it comes to actual science, right? They have no idea. And so, you're talking about people that a lot of people that think that the olive was born with the little orange thing inside, okay? And so people that want to ban hydraulic fracturing or want to create all sorts of fears in the public have a really easy time because they're working with a public that just doesn't understand a lot of these
right,
things.
Right, but would you agree though that I don't know that dams us to a situation where there's no capacity for future engagement. I think that with more information that there could be a much more rich and nuanced. And I think, Vic, to go back to your earlier question, in circumstances where people are given a bit more information, more nuanced questions, those are exercises where they're able to discern relative risk or to make talk more intelligently about this. And so I think that one of the prescriptions going forward really is more more information, not less, and not to assume that either side, if there are, even our sides, are sort of set in stone per se. This is a fluid and evolving circumstance, much as we see with a lot of public policy issues in the United States.
Because people aren't stupid, they're just ignorant.
Exactly. Yeah.
They're not stupid,
they're
ignorant.
It's a very important distinction.
Mm-hmm. Let me add one there too, because a couple of years ago, Henry Waxman, a congressman, put out a paper talking about the toxic chemicals that are used in fracking fluids and identified methanol as one of these toxic chemicals. Well, methanol is toxic, but if you look at it in context, and we actually did a report with the environmental consulting group Environ, looking at what's the potential impact of using methanol as a fracking fluid. First, it's got really good physical properties of fluid. It's used as an antifreeze for the water that's being injected. And that fracking fluid is actually mostly water and some sand. They had a little bit of chemicals, and methanol is one of them. But we looked at a couple of different scenarios. So what happens if a pipeline ruptures underground? And we know that methanol is readily biodegradable. Its half-life in groundwater is 1 to 7 days. And when you actually do the math, you do the numbers, it was not an environmental issue. It was relatively benign in using methanol as one of the aspects of these fracking fluids. So again, it was sort of put out there as these toxic chemicals, but you actually look at it, there wasn't a scenario where that fracking fluid and the methanol component of it would cause any environmental or human health harm.
Okay. I have a question to Brian. Can I jump in with a question? No.
Okay. Because I want to get the floor. You know what? If the floor is recalcitrant, then you will, because you may. Yes. Floor. Which questions from the floor? I'm going to be abusive here. Let's start there and then there. If you could go to the mic, that'd be wonderful. Then I don't have to repeat. It's right there. Carry it with you.
I was curious about the level of shale gas reserves. They tend to fluctuate depending on the year, the analysis, whether or not there's more or less than what we anticipated. And then secondly, if gas is discovered along with oil, and if oil prices are low and if oil's left in the ground, would that not then also suppress the supply of shale gas and therefore serve to increase the price of both commodities?
Okay, maybe I should take that one since I am player coach. I'll take that one. The reserves, well, the estimated shale gas in the ground in the U.S., that estimate is highly variable depending on the phase of the moon, in my opinion. Because part of the problem is this, you can't call something a reserve unless you can economically extract it, which means there has to be activity to extract that number. Let me say this, that from my reading of it, I've been following it for a while, when you write a bloody book, you tend to read a lot and because you're going to put it in print. So you tend to understand more about it. But I still could not, I can't get my arms around precisely how much there's going to be. But there certainly seems to be a lot of it. And the reason for that, and a whole chapter on it, is because of the way it's made. We have reason to believe that it's there. Worldwide, actually, not just in the U.S. So I think the source is going to be plentiful. Now, on the point about gas associated with oil, that is correct. Especially the light oil that shale oil produces has a lot of gas associated with it, which is right now a problem because we're flaring it. You know, in fact, the world is currently flaring about 5.4 trillion cubic feet a year, which is about $200 billion, no matter what the price of gas is, which is not only asinine from an economic standpoint, but also it puts greenhouse gas in there. And so these challenges have to be met. There are technologies being developed, much as, you know, as Greg said, when Annie said that, you know, in China, some of these provinces, the coal is land-bound. It can't really be economically taken anywhere. That is the situation with flared gas. And so technology has to meet the challenge there.
Yeah, Lynn Schlosser with the American Council of Engineering Companies. And my question is, where's the competition? What are the barriers to competition of natural gas producers getting into this value chain for transportation fuels? You would think with all the pipelines and all the reserve and a market present, there would be more there would be producers on your panel who would say, this is an opportunity, and here's my problem getting into that value chain. Can you explain that?
Which one of you? Greg, you want to take it, or you want to take any? If not, I will handle it.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting question because, you know, again, as I mentioned, there's been a big push in this country to use natural gas directly as a transportation fuel. But there's a lot of challenges. You know, one of the markets for liquefied natural gas is in heavy-duty trucking. Well, the incremental cost to have that truck capable of running on liquefied natural gas is about $100,000. Even for a fleet like UPS that has high mileage for their trucks, it takes them 7 years in fuel cost savings to recoup that incremental investment. So, you know, the question becomes, where's the economic value in doing something like that? And we think, you know, methanol can offer some of that economic value. Right now, it's a challenged environment because of the renewable fuel standard. You're assuming 10% of every gallon of gasoline sold is ethanol. And while we have some opportunity to use methanol along with ethanol in flex fuel vehicles, we really haven't seen that market development. There's another opportunity. Right now, the automakers need more octane in their fuels to get to 54 miles per gallon by 2025 under their CAFE requirements. Octane can come from alcohol, methanol, ethanol. Methanol is an octane of 117. So you add, say, 20 to 30% ethanol and methanol together to gasoline, then you've got 102 octane fuel pretty affordably. And that octane helps you do things like downsize engine, higher compression ratios, more turbocharging, direct fuel injection. It's sort of the enabler for these more efficient engines. And some of the automakers right now are starting to look at those opportunities for these sort of mid-level alcohol fuels. And I think that could be a real game changer for us going forward.
Annie?
And I think Lynn raises a really important point. The natural gas folks should be here, and they should connect the dots on this topic, because at the end of the day, if you want to get natural gas into the transportation sector, the easiest way to do it is to convert it into the liquid fuel methanol. It's cheapest on a light-duty vehicle. It's under $100 for an automaker to make a light-duty vehicle flex fuel that can run on methanol also. Even if you look at heavy-duty vehicles, at long-haul trucks, it's cheaper to enable them to run on methanol than to go either the CNG or the LNG route, and certainly cheaper than going the diesel control route to meet the current diesel emission standards. The obstacle is the fuel tank, and to remove that obstacle on the fuel tank, you either need a mandate or a regulatory incentive. Okay, so the mandate says to automakers, you need to open most of the cars in your fleet to fuel competition of some sort. Technology neutral, you choose the way. The incentive is the bill that Greg was alluding to, which says to automakers, if you open at least half the vehicles in your fleet to fuel competition of some sort, then the top line fuel economy number that you need to meet drops massively. And that's worth thousands of dollars to you without costing the taxpayer a dime. So we know if a bill like that, the Fuel Choice and Deregulation Act, Rand Paul's bill, would be put into place, that automakers would react. And if automakers open their fuel tanks, then you know that investors would see there's a tremendous opportunity here, because these fuels are economic, even at relatively low prices of oil. And they would massively expand capacity, and we'd get all these good things happening. But having the natural gas industry connect the dots and look at not just look at CNG and LNG as transportation fuel, but also think about methanol, also think about DME, also think about the different bills that can open, really open the transportation sector, not incrementally, but in a game-changing way. The fuels made out of their products, I guarantee you, if they came and lobbied the Hill, it would make a difference. Why they aren't doing that on this issue, I'm not sure.
So let me add one more point to your question to broaden it slightly. Natural gas, there'll be no barrier to usage for those things that use natural gas as a raw material anyway. Where they displace something like diesel with compressed natural gas problems, possibly, depending upon what the competitive fluid is. But for those things that use it automatically, no barrier. So for example, for coal displacement, especially a coal plant that does not meet environmental standards, happening will continue to happen. For ammonia and urea, which were imported products, is happening, will continue to happen, and so forth and so on. For steelmaking, I mean, I expect the U.S. to be the low-cost steelmaker in the world, in large part because, especially certain types of iron making, in large part because of low-cost natural gas. So very simply stated, where natural gas is a raw material, no barrier to entry per se, where it is going to displace something either directly or after conversion to something, it'll depend a little bit upon what it's competing with. And one last point. Both these guys have been talking about DME. Nobody's explaining, okay, so dimethyl ether, don't bother with the chemistry. But the point is, it is a fluid that can easily be converted from methanol. And Volvo, for example, has announced a Class 8 truck which will run pure DME. So let me explain DME. It's another chemical that comes from natural gas. Questions? You may now. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, Brian, you mentioned that there are several studies that show that the public is interested in regulation. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about what type of regulation you've seen in those studies and the names of them.
Repeat the question, please.
Yes. Okay. So it was a question about the interest in regulation, amongst various folks, there, admittedly, I haven't seen a literature where there is a wide and robust, discussion of all different, regulatory options per se. But there has been, for example, discussion of, the need for disclosure, from industry as to, what is in. Fluids that are being used, and in one instance, it was I think more than 80 or 90% of people supported mandated disclosure at that level. There are a variety of people working in this area, and we can certainly talk more later about specific authors, but I know, Rabe and Truelove and a number of other folks have been doing work where some of those questions have been included, but it's an avenue for further exploration as well. What I wanted to suggest was that while there is some expressed uncertainty, there also have been some instances where a large majority of people have expressed particular viewpoints and beliefs, and that type of notion of the importance of oversight, the importance of letting the general public know what's transparency in the process, that seems to be robust enough that that's passed peer review. So I'd be happy to talk further later about other evidence you might have in mind.
So let me add to that thing. I was not aware of that. So there was a study which showed that at least some population, is worried about chemical exposure. Now, that doesn't surprise me, but the newest regulation that North Carolina passed, because the latest state to pass new regs, in fact, has a lot of material on that. And there was a lot of discussion in the commission. I chaired that commission on that particular issue, which all of you have got the book. Therefore, I can refer to the book without appearing to be selling the book. But I have an entire chapter on that because it's a very pernicious issue. People really believe that chemical disclosures should be made and that if you know ifs, ands, or buts. But there is an if, which most regulations have, even the North Carolina one, which is, it's called the trade secret exclusion, that if something is an intellectual property, then it doesn't have to be disclosed. Again, it's nuanced, it's very hard to, which is why I wrote a whole darn chapter on it. But yeah, that we recognize that as a commission as a very difficult issue that at first blush, public will say, I have a need to know. And you say there's a study that actually demonstrates
right.
That.
It's probably important again there to be nuanced. That I think that there's been support, in disclosure, in transparency, that may be different than support, given all the information on the table as to what to do about that or any. It's just an interest in or a sense of need to know that that's deeply rooted in, American popular perception of many issues. And so that's that is what it is.
Annie, your question to Brian now.
I'm curious about this for minutes now.
I'm curious about financial incentive. Oh. And what I mean by that is you have had certain areas in which people that have mineral rights, obviously they want the shale to be developed. They want to gain the benefit. And then other people in their area that wouldn't get a direct financial benefit aren't too happy about that. And so the question is, if there's a formula here by which companies just certainly not be required to do it, but just out of their own interest to get things moving more swiftly and to forestall this type of opposition, just say, you know what, town X, even though only 30 people here have property that this would apply to, we're going to TIF, a small percent to the town or to every resident of the town or something like that, so everybody gets some sort of financial benefit. Have you studied how that would affect
them? I have not personally studied that, but in looking at the literature, it is fair to say that one of the predictors that seems to emerge certainly is whether or not one has mineral rights or has, and that distinction you talk about is a real one in terms of expressed support. A predictor of that seems to be some sense of financial incentive. What that right level would be to offer is an interesting and open question, and how that operates in direct conjunction with or as an offset against other risks, that's yet to be studied. So I think I wouldn't go so far as to venture that there is a magic recipe per se because there are multiple other considerations and it would be interesting to see how that fit in. But it is a fair statement to suggest that there is widespread understanding that there are financial opportunities and that those are sometimes motivating in terms of people's support. So there does seem to be documentation for that. And what you talk about is an interesting possibility. It would be interesting to see in the context of a broader discussion about the various trade-offs where that ranked as a predictor of support.
So. Let me add to that. it's interesting that the public was prepared to pay for water cleanup type of things, but not for roads. For the information of everybody, it, in North Carolina and also in Pennsylvania in the revised regulation, two things have happened. One is that the operator, which is the oil and gas company, is required to remediate any water situation, and there are rules and regulations to figure out that something happened. There is presumptive liability in North Carolina of any contamination within half a mile of a rig. Presumptive liability, which means you're essentially proven guilty before you're guilty before you're proven innocent. And on the roads, Pennsylvania's regulation has an impact fee, much of which is distributed to the local community, not to the state. We picked up on that in North Carolina, and we have suggested to the legislature to do that. That was not within our purview to impose taxes. But that's the way to go, because in my personal view, the roads are being damaged by the operator because of the heavy truck traffic, and there's no question about causality there, and therefore they should pay for it. So the public should not be required to pay for that. Questions? Yes.
It seems to me the last couple of questions have started to get on some of the micro level impacts or considerations, whereas the earlier part of the conversation on international and markets was more macro. And I'm wondering, Brian, on a social science level, is there a good way to really get at how people can balance those two, whether they factor micro or macro greater, or is it in the framing of the question? I know this is an issue for things beyond fracking, so I'm wondering if there's perhaps research that can be pulled upon from other issues.
Yeah. Let me rephrase that question, because I'm interested in that too, which is, to what degree is the public able to balance a national interest such as national security, which is very ephemeral, versus I'm breathing dirty air? Anybody, it started, Brian.
Right, well, and I'm happy to offer just an initial comment, but I would be interested to know what others have to think about this as well. It's important to keep in mind, for a lot of public perception research, what's salient, right? And so that's going to be a function of the news environment, of individual circumstance, and this notion of inviting or soliciting, a multi-level, perspective, is an interesting one. It's one that's not often, done, because a lot of our discussions are on one level or another, just as we've been guilty of, even here. And so I think I have faith and confidence in people, to be able to consider various, factors given the right circumstance of conversation where that's invited in. I think it really requires a larger narrative in which we tie those pieces together. And again, it goes back to my earlier worry about a lot of these discussions being sort of ships passing in the night, if you will, because we aren't connecting those dots. So I guess, we see in other areas, perhaps where there's been a longer history of public engagement, where there is more nuance in terms of the expressed understanding, and I think people have capacity for that. I just think it means framing this not as just a science issue or just a public policy issue or just an international relations issue, but rather thinking it as a social issue for us to consider from a variety of viewpoints. So it'll be interesting to see once that gets into election campaigns and in a broader discussion, different ways that that's framed and discussed. But what do you both think about the possibility for this kind of conversation?
Looking at it at the political level and what impacts politicians and members of Congress and so forth, after 9/11, people really cared about national security. It seems to me that people have really gone to sleep on this issue. People that aren't in military families, that don't have a direct relationship that way, for the most part, not everybody, but certainly for the most part, seem to have gone to sleep on this issue, on the issue of radical Islam and so forth. And so I think for most members of Congress, not an issue that can any longer affect policy that's outside of direct defense policy. So energy policy or things like that, whereas in the years after 9/11, members of Congress were much more willing to understand the link there between oil, national security, and the energy policy that's required to deal with it. Unfortunately, that can and will change because bad things will happen to us. Okay, the course of human history has had very few periods of peace and prosperity. We've lived through very exceptional times, and they will not last, unfortunately. So we are going to get a wake-up call, and the issue will rise up again to the headlines, and all sorts of policy will be passed to address it. But until that point, I think, you know, politics are local. Politicians listen to what their constituents say, and they listen to what the money says. And the money is the various industry lobbyists and so forth that fund them on all sides of the issue. It's not one side. It's all sides of the issue. So for the most part, that's not every politician, but I think most politicians have a very, very local focus. And if their constituents aren't annoyed about prices or they aren't mad about, you know, bad air, and the air in the U.S. really has been really quite excellent, you know, and everything to do with fracking will only improve the air across all dimensions at the end of the day, because gas is cleaner than coal. So, and it's cleaner than oil, too. There's nothing to really bind these issues together, not because they shouldn't be bound together, but because that's just the way the political process works. What's not urgent is not paid attention to.
We also have, in both the House and Senate right now, they're debating comprehensive energy bills. Neither bill has a transportation title. I can't remember in the last 20 years energy legislation that didn't even address transportation. And I guess just today, because of it's a low gasoline, low oil price environment, it just falls off the radar screen, and the politicians just don't pay attention to it. But if you were to be more forward-looking and looked ahead where, you know, we probably won't have $40 a barrel forever, it could go back up to $65, $70 by 2017, 2018, you know, this is a perfect time to be looking at stimulating alternative fuels. Might also be a perfect time to think about things like excise taxes and what's the appropriate level of having excise taxes to support our real need for a transportation infrastructure. But there's not a whole lot of will to address that either.
You know, Vic's put each of us on the spot, but I'll put Vic on the spot just for a moment, because talking of binding together, you know, these issues, you attempt to do that in the different editions of your book, actually. And I'm just curious what the your reception to that has been. Because you span, frankly, you know, large you know, issues, and then get into micro level, you know, details of chemistry. What's your sense been of how people have engaged with that as an entree into popular discussion? Because I think it actually goes back to this question. Have you found people be equally engaged with the different chapters, if you will? Because they really are, they're macro micro chapters.
Some of the feedback we got on the first edition was that they were surprised by some of the things affecting Shale that were affected. They were surprised by the national security piece, by the way, which is why I wrote a whole chapter on it. So I would say that things of that sort, which tend to books or seminars that tend to blend things together will just generally improve perceptions. But yeah, I thought people were engaged, but I also wrote the book so you can read any chapter out of sequence, so people jump to it. So I'm not sure to what extent that was successful. We have time for one more question. We have 2.5 minutes left. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Deanna Trost from Vanguard. You just mentioned gas being burning cleaner than coal. And we've heard a lot about the transportation sector today, but what about the electricity sector? I mean, people are familiar with the clean power plan. So what's the shale gas role in implementing the clean power plan, for example?
Look, I'll take that one because it's a very important question relating to, I'm going to make a flat statement. Low-priced shale gas is going to hurt renewables. Is hurting renewables, will continue to hurt renewables, and there's little one can do about it except through policy. Now, fortunately, some of the renewables are stepping up. Solar in certain parts of the world, including this country, is competitive. So you don't want to force feed it where you shouldn't. I'm really surprised Hamburg has enough sunlight for all the subsidies that West Germany put down there. Not West anymore, I'm old. Solar is getting very competitive, and wind in the right place is very competitive already. When I say competitive, it means the good price in that place through the alternatives. But there's no question that renewables will be held back. But where it can be helped
is the renewables through, for example, methanol and DME can be made from biogas, from gas from landfills, gas from swine lagoons, and those things will continue to happen. The key reason I had these people bring methanol to the table was it is the easiest chemical to make from stuff, from methane and from biogas. It's just easiest. I don't play favorites. Somebody wants to make diesel, that's cool too. But yes, the other sources are going to be hurt. And even coal, it's interesting. Coal price, if it drops, they go back and forth. You will see that in May, I think, there was more natural gas used for power than coal. And by July, that had already dropped back. So as long as you have dual fire capability, it'll go back and forth. Sorry, long answer. And we are actually out of time. Is Aaron going to close things, or am I going to close things? OK. So, well, actually, we started late, but we did finish in time. I don't know if we left anything on the table. I think we probably did. I expected a few more questions on the environmental impacts. I opened that door, but nobody walked through it. But let me give you an opinion. My opinion is that proper regulation, also properly enforced, which is very much state by state, by the way. The feds have abdicated in many ways in this area. Proper regulation, properly enforced, and then bolstered by informed community action can, I believe, safely deliver these fluids. And if I didn't believe that, I would not have said that in my book and elsewhere. But there's a lot of those steps there. We need the right regulations. We do need the enforcement. And we do need public activism of an informed sort, which is why I had Brian, to figure out how can they may be more informed. So that is my small summing up. Thank you very much. Thank you, folks.